Okay, so neuroplasticity is an interesting word. Neuro means like the nerve cells in our brain. Plasticity means our brain is like plastic. It can change all the time. It's not fixed, which is pretty amazing, which is a very important thing. It can change its shape and its function. Whatever we think, whatever we learn, whatever action we do, it does it for us. It helps us to do it. So here's the catch about mindfulness. When we practice mindfulness meditation, or mindfulness meditation, positive thinking, visualization, and imagery, we change our brain structure. We change our function to accommodate whatever we're thinking, feeling, doing, or sensing. The more we practice, the stronger the neural connections become, the more skilled we become. There's a rule called the 10-year rule. I have so many slides, I don't want to pull all this stuff in this few hours. But the 10-year rule in neuroscience is now that if you practice something for 10 years, and you practiced it like an hour a day or 2 hours a day for 10 years or so many hours, that you would become a prodigy in performance, whether it was violin or piano, for instance. There's a number of studies that have been done in conservatories where tests have been run and observations have been run on people who play violin. People in all these studies who play the violin for 5,000 hours during their lifetime in their conservatory, which is like 4 years, they end up to be like really excellent violinists. The people that practice 7,500 hours, 2,500 hours more, actually reach the state of national class performers. The people that practice for 10,000 hours, what do you think they become? World-class performers. It's the number of hours that you dedicate to it. And as you dedicate that, that brain builds more and more neural networks. I've got so many slides, I don't want to stop to do too many. So when we reorganize our neural networks in our brain, and when they get stronger or they get weaker, or they serve us or they don't serve us, what happens is that our brain changes how we respond to the world in a certain way, how we perceive the world in a certain way, how we act in the world in a certain way, and how we imagine and think in the world in a certain way. For instance, if we respond to the world, and this is important for all of us, as a place that has opportunity, and every day we wake up and we say, this place has opportunity. I can make it happen. We say that all the time. The brain's going to actually develop a neural network for that. It's going to fire neurons. The more you think that, the stronger it's going to get. But if you think this world is against me, it's a horrible place to be, doesn't have any opportunities, you're going to develop a neural network for that. So you're going to be pretty good at thinking either that it's got opportunities or it doesn't have opportunities. How we perceive the world. Is the world a friendly place? Or is the world a scary place? Right? Think about that all the time. Develop a neural network of fear or one of a friendly place. When you act in the world in a certain way, when you act with courage and compassion, you get a neural network of courage and compassion. And it's much easier to act in that place. When you act with anger and meanness, you're going to develop neural networks of anger and meanness. When you think and imagine in a certain way, when you imagine yourself being radiantly healthy, a very beautiful person, very calm, it's going to happen up here. If you imagine yourself to be sickly, I don't like the way I look, I'm too this, I'm too that, you're going to build a neural network for that. And at some point, you're going to either build neural networks that are going to make you courageous and successful, you have to use the word successful, and have a lot of well-being, or you're going to create some good victim ones. And you're going to be a pretty good victim or a pretty good hero. That's just the point. Right? It's not. You know, it's just whatever you think, those thoughts are going to happen. You're going to change your brain. That's called neuroplasticity. Okay. So, this is the Buddha. Buddha was indigenous. The mind is everything, he said. What you think, you become, which is we now know is true. Just like I was talking about with neuroplasticity. Everything you think, you become up here. Does that mean you become it out here? Sometimes. So, what we're going to do is look at now some scans of brains. And we're going to look at what happens when people meditate and why meditation is so important. This first picture is a picture that was in National Geographic. This is a monk who was hooked up with all these EEGs. And so as he was meditating, just like you were doing, you had you all hooked up with these EEGs, you'd find out where your brain was going, what it was doing. If it was kind of living in the fear part of the brain, or a healthy part of the brain, or an optimistic part of the brain, or wherever it would be. You know, we've got this technology where we can do that. It's really pretty exciting stuff, because we can see actually how what the brain looks like on meditation. For instance, this is a brain. This is what happens to the state of the brain. Like, what happens? In the front of your brain, go like this. Okay, then go to your left side up here. You see the left side? That left side of your brain is associated with optimism, with healthy thoughts, with well-being. The right side is just the opposite. It's a side associated with dark thoughts, fear, anguish, those kind of sad thoughts, that kind of thing. So when you look at a person at rest, you see this, the red, that means it's active. Kind of red here, kind of in the mid part of the brain, prefrontal cortex. But when a person, that's just at rest, when a person starts to meditate like you were doing, you see how much more of that left prefrontal cortex gets engaged, how much more it's lit up, it actually connects this piece here. This means that feelings of optimism, well-being, happiness, are all starting to sort of engage here. And this has been cut off. It's gotten a little bigger, but it's also aware of those other thoughts too as well. This here is what we call the occipital lobe. This is the seeing part of the brain. So even though it is meditating, the brain is still seeing something here. Maybe it's visualizing good health or a good body or good thoughts, whatever it is. This is another thing we know about the brain. In transcendental meditation, we know that the trait of the brain changes, that over time, as we meditate like you were doing just earlier, what we can do is we can incorporate more of our brain into doing a task. This is before you actually do the meditation and what's going on, but after training, you see how much more the brain is engaged to solve a problem, to think about what it is, to whatever it is. It could be like learning how to sing a song, learning how to speak a language, learning how to solve a problem, learning how to get along better with your wife or your husband or your children, learning how to sleep better, whatever. It's all these different kinds of things. So it's a response to whatever the somatosensory, whatever is out there, whatever your body is experiencing, whatever your brain is experiencing, whatever you're experiencing in the world, you get a greater participation and of the whole brain, which makes maybe your actions more successful. So when you saw the monk with all of those connections on, that was called EEG. So here's what we know. Long-term meditators have higher levels of alpha and theta band activity. Now we're going to see pictures of that, but just remember that alpha and theta band activity is associated with sleep and rest, so it's calm, it's relaxed. So when you're wide awake, it can feel like you're in a deep state of rest. It's almost like you're sleeping, but you're not. So it's not sleeping, but it's at that level where you feel like you're well-rested and alert, calm. Meditation practices that emphasize deep physical relaxation, like just relax, just learning how to relax all parts of your body, relaxing your mind, your fingers, and your talk through that, and you learn how to do that, produce higher theta and delta activity. We'll look at these terms, but just remember that theta and delta activity are associated with deep sleep, and again, even calmer. People can even be very, very alert, but have a sense of real calm, as they do a lot of those kind of meditation practices. There are practices that focus more on intensive concentration, concentrating on a sacred object, concentrating on doing your math problem, concentrating on a conversation, concentrating on learning how to do whatever it is you're trying to do, play the piano. Those produce higher alpha and beta band activity. We'll take a look at it and see what those look like. So, here are all the these are your brain waves. This is what's going on in your brain right now. So you're engaged right now. You're probably maybe at a beta somewhere because you're alert, you're thinking. But maybe you're not a real high beta right now unless you're really thinking hard. But if you started talking and really started debating, then your beta levels would go up. So you see that 13.30 cycles per second? That is related to being awake and aware. Extroversion, going up and talking and visiting with people, you know, and it's also concentration is really good. Your logical thinking is going on. Active conversation, having a conversation with someone, that's all related to a beta. So a debater would be in high beta, really having a debate with someone. A person making a speech or a teacher or a talk show host would all be engaged in beta because they're just actively thinking about whatever they have to say or whatever they do. Right now, the way I'm talking, probably sort of in the mid-range beta right now, just giving my presentation, right? But as I really start to try to convince you and start pulling in all kinds of information and talking quicker, and then try to argue about this and that, my beta starts to go up. Alpha, going down now. See, that's like, those are like, how quickly they go, like this. Now alpha, you see, it's kind of slowing down. You see that? They're getting bigger, kind of wider. 7 to 13 cycles per second. Alpha is a good state to be in. Relaxation, non-arousal, hypnosis or meditative states, but very relaxed. Theta now, this is like when you're getting to that point where you're having daydreams, really getting lost in class or someone's talking to you, you're like at a theta, you're just so relaxed, right? Someone said, well, what happened? So I got really, really relaxed and maybe kind of got closer to theta. Probably not, more of a kind of a lower alpha. Dreaming. Creativity starts to happen when you get to this level. Meditation brings it on. Paranormal phenomenon, for example, out-of-body experiences, ESP, you know, out-of-body journeys, those things are all associated with getting down to that trained theta level. I haven't talked about gamma, though, because gamma is the highest. It's really, really active thought. But it's good and bad. So gamma waves, as opposed to these slower waves, the gamma waves are like this. It's almost like a straight line. It gets higher for these Tibetan Buddhist monks than for, you know, people who are not Buddhist monks. I'll say during when they're resting, they're just sort of resting. They're not doing a meditation. But when they start to do a loving kindness meditation, like I showed you, may my enemy be free from pain. May my enemy be free from fear. That brainwave starts to really go. Because they're very aware, very focused, very in tune with what they're thinking about, right? So they fire, there are brain waves associated with perception and neural consciousness. My perception gets really, really strong, really, really clear. And that's kind of getting clear with my four-year-old daughter now. Her perception is going like this. She's only four, but she's been training for a couple of years. It's going up like this, it's raising. Perception, her awareness, right? Does she have meltdowns? Yes, she still has meltdowns. But she's very conscious about things. She's very conscious. But that's why it's so important to start with children at a very early age. So long-term meditators have the ability to put their state, put their brain into a state which is maximally sensitive and consumes power at a lower, even zero rate. Long-term meditators achieve a gamma wave like this. And so when they achieve that, that brain is maximally sensitive. I can sense what you think. I can sense how much money you got in your pocket. Not quite that. But you get, you know, flow of what's going on. Really clear, right? Now we'd say this is probably what spiritual leaders, a lot of holy people kind of got to that level. Really aware, sensitive about how an animal was or how another person was. My father was like that, and we kind of became, despite all the dysfunction, we became like the horses. We're horse people. We got to really read a horse. If you've ever seen that movie, Avatar, it's like you plug into the animal, right? Plug into the horse.